So it's going to go through very, so you will see there are many slides. I'm going to be very quick on some of the slides. So we, some parts are subliminal presentation. So you will have access to the slides there. They're going to talk about the basics of power analysis. Then I will leave the floor to Giulio that will focus on a specific thing, a specific approach to power analysis that I will say in a moment. So to start with, that's what I should do. Very, yeah, I'm ashamed of myself where I'm starting really, really from scratch. And then I move on to different aspects. And I will try to focus not too much, a little bit also the details, but mostly in terms of understanding what is going on there and what are the problems involved in power analysis. Or how you can approach. So, why power analysis? Because it's an important tool, not the only tool. We are going to see very quickly another tool, but there are other tools instead of power analysis, but it's an important tool in climate studies, testing hypotheses. So to understand it, we need to go back to some theory effects. That's the mean, you know. So I will go very quick. But the point being, there is a single value that central that summarizes a lot of data at a single point. Now, does I want to move? Okay, when you have a mean, you have one of the many possible. Sorry, I'm pregnant. So I'm very keen on Bayesian kind of thinking, but just to be put things on the table, as they were. So I'm talking about standard error. But Bayesian would say, what is a standard error? It doesn't exist. So that's why I thought I declared myself rather than. So when you have a mean, you have one of the many possible values that you could have if you were to do the study many times. So you have just one. Bayesian would say, that's it. That's my world. That's my data. And I would say, nah, that's one of the many possible worlds that you could have, given that time to collect the kind of data that you're trying to collect. So to understand the mean, you need to think in terms of, okay, but that's not the real value. It's one of the possible values. How do I know? What is the range of possible values? That the standard error. And the standard error is a very simple concept, but as they say, you are stuck in an island for all your life and you can choose only one concept, choose the standard error. With a key concept in statistics. It's a very important concept because it's the bridge between what you see and what you don't see. What you see is the sample. What you don't see is the population. You would like to say something about the population, not on your data. You are trying to make inferences from your data in terms of other people, generalizability, like you might say today. No, you are trying to generalize what the people, the things. Of course, you need stimuli, you need to take into account, but before even that, you need to understand that if you try to generalize, you are trying to say something about something that you don't see. And that's the inference. Now, you know what I mean? The standard error is a way to get a sense of how much wrong you can be, the inaccuracy in your estimate. So that's the way it works. If, just to give an example, everyone, depending on your data, if asks you, do you drink water every day? Then my standard error probably is not existing. Just ask one person, there is no error in that. It's a kind of almost no variation. The more variation there are, the more variation there is, the more there is standard error. That's a general kind of concept. And this is captured by two, that's again this very simple equation. And it depends on the variability variance and depends on the sample size. Meaning that the more there is variability in the data, the more people are different from each other, the more there is error in your specific estimate. Everything else being equal. The more people you have, the less there is error in your estimate. Everything else being equal. These are the two key quantities. So the standard error goes up, it goes down, and you can see it very quickly. Now, this up is what you never see. I mean, with statistical packaging, you can see also the impossible. So you never see the population, basically. But suppose that there is this population, the only thing that you see this thing. And this is the mean, and that's the confidence interval of the mean. So bottom line is, you have the exact same value in the mean, different standard error, and then the variability of what you see, which is all this part,
Il mouse è solo nel game.
Ah, io non see anything. promote.
Yes.
The defense, the good practice. Okay. So this is basically the competence interval, or standard error is the same as you will see. Basically, the point is, the less there is variability, given the same mean, every sample is going to give you basically the similar information. Here, you have wide differences in the type of information you get, simply because there is more variability given the same sample size. If you move this, and you increase sample size, given the same variability, the error is less. That's the main point. It's very simple. And from the standard error, you can construct the confidence interval. So the confidence interval is expressed in a different matrix, but it's the same principle. It's a measurement error. Basically, it's telling you not to be mixed up with the credibility interval. It's not telling you 95% or less with these parameters there. That's the credibility interval. The confidence interval is telling you, if you were to repeat the study 100 times, 95% of the time, you'll find your parameter within this range. That's what it's telling. And that's basically how it works, and reflect the concept of accuracy, parameter estimation. So which means basically it's telling you, so just a pretty practical example. Suppose there is a kind of ad, and you want to understand whether an ad has is efficacy or not. So in one case, you have a scale which goes from zero, but you have plus means positive, minus means negative. So you have this one, plus 3.10, standard deviation 15, plus 2.50, standard deviation 15. They are equally both significant. So what is the best type? You'll say, okay, obviously say, as higher means. I would say, nah, depends. If you want to have a risky strategy, A is the best type. But the confidence interval of A is much wider. So you could end up here, 0.16, 6.05. Remember, this seems to be a technical information, but it's not. The distribution of the confidence interval is flat, is uniform. So what? It means that every value is equally likely. It doesn't mean that the mean value is more likely than everyone else. It means it could be anywhere in between 0.6 and 6.04. It doesn't mean, okay, but 3.10 is more likely, it's the mean obvious. No, the distribution is flat. Could be anywhere in between. So it's really important to reduce. And the second one gives you, on average, less, but you have much less risk. Because 95% is lower, so you can have less gain, you can have less losses. So the point is, what you decide depends on your risk coverage. So you should accept more risk or less risk. So just to say that the accuracy is important. Now, effect size, we already talked, so I'm going to be very quick, but there are different ways to measure effect size. As we saw, the most common, one of the most common within this framework is Cohen-Stee, which has already been said, the differences between means relative to the variability in the data. And then you can go from correlation to Cohen-Stee, correlation distribution, to the most common correlation and Cohen-Stee. You can go from one to the other. I will skip the example of Cohen-Stee. We already assume that you know, we already discussed the effect size, but the bottom line only to say that it's telling you how important is the difference between the means relative to the variability between the means. So, has very small difference can be hugely important if the variability is minute, is trivial. The more the variability is large, the more you need a big difference to have an effect size, large effect size. That's the kind of logic. Then there are conventional values, but you know, this is something like this. The important part to know is that there is no such a thing like one effect size index. There are a bunch of effect size index, depends on your level of measurement, depends on what you're interested in, and so on and so forth. Depends on your design. This is just a list of some of them, not all of them, or the different effect size index. Now, it might seem confusing, but the point is, if you look to the essence of it, they share the same logic. The logic is signal on the numerator, noise on the denominator. It's the ratio between the signal and the noise. Conceptually, signal means your effect of interest means the difference between the means. Noise means the variability, generic variability. So really is telling you something in terms of single notes, conceptually speaking. This has the many different details. These are some of the questions. Now, why do you do this stuff? Because you want to make some inputs based on this stuff. So you calculate, I mean, you want to make some inputs based on some parameters. You can have different types of approach, and that I mentioned only here, I already said before, this is a pragmatic approach, this is a Bayesian approach, which is great. So, but I focus on this one. And within this approach, there are three types of inputs. The most commonly known is type 1 and type 2, which is false positive, false negative. And these are linked to the null hypothesis significant test, which means this is significant, yes, no. You can get it right, you can get it wrong. These are, in two words, type 1, type 2. And then there is another type of error, which is the imprecision of the estimate. So how much you are accurate or inaccurate in terms of your estimate. And this is what now is called the new statistics, I mean, the kind of movement there, which is this book. I recommend everyone to read this book. It's a very nice book. This is the last edition. But the point is that from that perspective, the null hypothesis significant testing is a secondary issue. It's the estimate in the parameter, which is the main point. So the error is defined in terms how the mistakes you make in estimating parameters. Remember, it's under error. That's the control behind. If you go for the first type of error, type 1, type 2, that's one way, kind of classical way to understand this, which means basically, again, always you have your sample, what you see, and what you don't see. Your sample is in front of you. From there, you extract some values, and you wonder, is this value the right in the population? So you make some conclusion based on the sample, and you might get it right or might get it wrong. That's the basic. So depending on the cross between these two simple decisions, decision is null, the null hypothesis is true. I cannot reject the null hypothesis to be more specific, more precise, versus the null is false, I can reject the null hypothesis. So that's what you decide on your sample. And this can be true or false in the combination. Depending on the combination, you can be right, correct decision, or you can make an error, type 1, type 2 error. That's the concept of errors in statistical inference from a pragmatist perspective. In terms of the decision that you make based on the parameters that you estimate. Now, type 1 error is false positive, it means erroneously rejecting null hypothesis. Basically, the results in your sample is significant. You are wrong. That's basically a behind the false positive. The type 2 error is just the opposite side. Basically, you look at your data, you say, bugger, nothing comes out, and then so you are depressed. And then, as a matter of fact, there was a result. So you fail to get something that was there. These are the two types of error, false negative, false positive. How can you eliminate this type of errors? I think there's only one way, you change job. So you become, I don't know, in a religion, you go in politics, you go in other jobs where you can pretend that there is. If you want to stay in science, you cannot eliminate these errors. You can only try to reduce them, to control these errors. So, how to control this type of errors? Type 1 error is the false positive, and that's the alpha. You know, the kind of your little friend, the p-value alpha, that's where it comes from. It's one way to control for the type 1 error. Alpha equal to 0.05, which means p-value 0.05. It means that you are happy if you make 5 mistakes out of 100 times you do your test. But you don't want to make mistakes. Again, change job. In this job, you will make mistakes. The point is that how many you accept. So, 5%. That's the standard conventional alpha. You can have two tests, one test, which the difference being basically the kind of question you ask yourself, is this greater than, and that is a mistake, or this different from? And that's the two-tailed test. The logic is the same. The type 2 error, instead, is the false negative. The false negative is basically when you don't find something that is there, but you don't find. And this is called beta, like the other one was called alpha. Now, the complement to beta within the statistical perspective, 1 minus beta, is pi. So power basically can be defined as the probability of finding an effect if this effect exists. Mm-hmm. Because it's the opposite of probability of missing an effect if the effect exists. So it's 1 minus beta. Now, conventionally, a power of 0.20, 0.80 is considered as acceptable. Now, this is, again, it's a suggestion by Cole. With some of this stuff, there is no time, but perhaps if you are in Antarctica, I'll tell you how the story of the 0.05 came about. Why 0.05? Well, there is a whole story. The same for 0.80. Somebody wrote in a book saying, well, 0.80 is not affected. Everybody, well, 0.80. It's like, I mean, what is there besides the joke? The point is that this reflects how much importance you give to missing something as opposed to finding something. And suppose you are in a context in which you need to detect a terrorist somewhere in a high-risk area. Well, you do not accept false negative. You're going to be power 29. You want a test to detect COVID. You want power 0.99. You are not happy with power 0.99 and so on. So, how much power you want, how much alpha you want, it depends really on the kind of question you are there. In the context of judicial trial, usually there is the kind of, is the opposite, in the sense of without reasonable doubts, which means if you have some reasonable doubts, you don't come to a conclusion. So you prefer to risk something as opposed to put somebody in jail when he wasn't or she wasn't culpable, what she did your thinking about. So, and so on and so forth. Just to say that there's nothing fixed, depends on the decision framework in which you are in, the kind of tradition within your, in psychology, that's always been often considered primitive. In the last years, because of the replicability concern, sometimes it has been pushed, especially for replication concern, 0.90, and so on and so forth. But that's technology. Now, this is only to move to power demands. Given all this, what is power? It's about, as we saw, finding something if it is exists. So you can have it in different ways. I'm going to say it as simple as possible in terms of focusing on what is influencing power. The key determinants of power is the decision criterion alpha, which means how many times you want to get it wrong, you're happy to get it wrong, sample size, the effect size, and how much power you want. Basically, type 1, type 2 error. Sample size, effect size. The beauty is that if you fix one of the elements, you can derive all the other. So, just to have a very simple initial concept, if you fix alpha 0.05 and power 0.8, which is 1 minus beta, you can plot how many participants you need given the effect size. And you can say, okay, these are the number of participants I need, so on and so on. That's the kind of logic of power now. Now, the point is, okay, this is how I find power. But why should I bother? So what are the kind of, I mean, sorry, before I go there, what affects power? What kind of things are influencing power? Power goes up with larger effect size and larger sample size. If you fix the decision criteria, there are only two other parameters. Larger effect size, larger sample size. What does it mean, larger sample size? I think is, you know, more power. Or those things from a designer's team. I'll come to that. When the effect size is larger, the effect size is larger when the signal is stronger than the noise. So when the effect of interest is larger than the generic variation in the data. So you think in terms of power, when power goes up, when the effect size goes up. When the effect size, okay, obviously, but also when the effect size goes up. This has a similar. And you can see another better way to think in terms of power is not to think in terms of an equation, you have to have a solution, but to think in terms of scenarios, which look for a range of possible solutions. That's important because, as we shall see, is how to say it's let's say inaccurate to think that you can have a power estimation. You can have a possible range of reasonable power estimation. That's the best you can do. Anyhow, so this is a function of different effect size, total sample size, and power. So you can have also three-dimensional representation there. Now, how you can increase power? Sample size goes up, signal goes up, noise goes down. Once again, these are its implications. We're going to see the implication of some quickly, some implication, but general kind of ideas that increase the signal, reduce the noise. Now, what is affected by power? By definition, power, higher power means less force. That's by definition. But the point is that directly, indirectly also means that basically you reduce your efforts. Because in statistics, you have the what is called crucial error rates, which depends also on the base rates. So, which means that you can, depending on, if you have higher power, bottom line, to make it simple, if you have higher power, you don't only do directly less time to errors, but also less time to errors. In general, you do less mistakes. And lower power, the opposite means, with multiple outcomes, and hypothesizing after the effects are known, you have a body completely evidence-limited. So you have one study saying this, the other study saying that, the other study again saying this, and so on and so on. Sometimes it's just an artifact. It's a consequence of slow power. And hypothesizing cannot present the evidence. And there's a second point, with population bias, you will have many false positives. I'm going to this in the last day, the last lecture. I will develop some of these points in terms of what you should do in your design, what kind of things you can do, what kind of things you can do to anticipate these problems, to reduce the impact of these problems. So why power analysis? As I said, if you have no logistical constraints, you should forget about power. You just go for accurate estimate. That's it. It's as simple as this. And inaccuracy, it's a very simple answer. This, again, one of the kind of basic things in statistics, more data is better than less data. I see that. And if you are concerned about accuracy, you don't even ask yourself, is the effect exist or not? You ask yourself, what is the value of this effect? And then, if it's different from zero, well, it's different from zero, great. But that's the point, that you ask yourself. And you can ask Cohen, paradoxically, which was, I mean, paradoxically, since ironically, the person who invented power analysis, somehow, say, all effects of this given an infinite sample size. So you wonder, so what am I doing? Why am I looking at power analysis? The point is that we are in an imperfect world, in which we have constraints, costs, and we cannot do everything at once. We have to make decisions, and given this, you have to make practical choices. If you take it from the perspective of accuracy, if you want, this is basic, if you want to make it right, increase sample size. Can even chart it if you want to try it, increase it. It's faster. That's the kind of very simple message. And that's the difference between precision and power. Now, if you look for this here and this two here, this chroma, this is zero, right? This is the confidence interval. It means that it's not significant, neither here nor there. From a null hypothesis significant testing, this is bad, this is good. From a precision perspective, this is good and this is bad. I'm accurately saying that the effect is around zero. I'm accurately saying that the effect is difficult. Yes, somewhere. It's better than, and perhaps it's zero. I cannot reject that, but it's so large that there. So that's the cause. So precision is valuable, no matter everything else. The minor practical problem is in big sample size. So whereas power, I mean, this is very, to make it very quick. There are different lines of different powers here, different effect sizes. So the bottom line is that power, we already saw before, how many participants you need goes down if the effect size goes up. Precision. Not, doesn't matter the effect size, still is large unless you have a big sample size. So if you were to do, I don't know, fMRI study, to be precise, you need still thousands of participants if you want to be precise there. Or, as they do, you exploit thousands of data points, but that's not the point. The point is, again, this is the main difference. And the main difference is also a practical important difference. It cannot be underestimated. And sometimes you have the, it's also an ethical consideration. You have the, you have to be, you have the duty to be efficient. I mean, to allocate your resources in a kind of reasonable manner, which means sometimes that's where the power analysis becomes important, because it's a practical tool that allows you to make cost, I mean, balancing on cost-benefit decision in terms of how many participants need to allocate. Yeah, what's the question?
Yes, so these is there any instance where like a large side effect would affect, a large population would affect the size effect?
Large population, sorry?
Is there any instance in which a large population would affect the size effect?
In terms of precision?
Yes.
In terms of the effect size?
Yes. So
the effect size, population large and effect size are, should be correlation zero, should be in between.
So there is no instance in which we might have too large population?
Ah, too large population.
Yes.
Oh, from the perspective of accuracy, there is no such a thing like too large population.
Yeah, but there is a kind of bias for correlation effect size, let's say, because the higher the sample size, the smaller the correlation in a way.
Well, I'll come to this in a Friday, which is about, we'll talk about the publication bias. Statistically speaking, there should be zero correlation between effect size and sample size. Practically speaking, the correlation is 0.5, what I'm going to say, the publishing literature. Because the problem is publication bias. You have a small data set with non-significant results, you don't publish them. Small data set with significant results, you try to publish them. Which means you're going to have a very skewed distribution of data. And this is especially true when the sample size is small. When it's large, it doesn't make any difference anymore because significance becomes, the concept of significance becomes increasingly irrelevant when the population is large. And so that's one of the implications. But we're going to go on Friday on this point. So how do you do it? How to calculate power? There are different ways, different software routines. Julia will present on R. I will say something about G-Power. And also I will say something about another software as well. And many of these calculations are based on also, not only, but on this paper that we published, also with Julia, a couple of 3 years ago, simple design and power calculation for simple design. And there are also routines available there. G-Power is a very simple software, it's a free software, and it's very commonly used for power analysis, for simple power analysis. And you can have, I mean, I'm not going to explain all the details of G-Power, but bottom line is that you have here choices of the type of analysis. You say what type of power analysis, just I will mention this in a second. Let me say now, you can do power analysis a priori or power analysis after the data. The power analysis after the data, it's a mistake. I would say if you were something, but it doesn't exist, concept of power analysis after the data. I mean, it's a trivial retransformation of your results in a different way. So the power analysis makes sense before the data, or you can do a sensitivity analysis even after the data, which can be very informative, but not the power analysis. Post-op. Unfortunately, the software allows for this. The a priori is the classical one. The sensitivity is another very interesting one. So you ask here, you put inputs, effect sizes, so on and so forth, and then action buttons, and you have some. Let's say a very simple example, two independent groups. You say, that's the effect size I expect, 0.05, alpha, 0.05, power, 0.80. You see, three things. And then you calculate for the four. How many participants are here? 128 in this example. That's it, as simple as this. That's a good practice before you try to do this to have an estimate of how many participants you need. You can also look at sensitivity analysis. Sensitivity analysis is similar logic, but these times you start from N. What is the logic? And sometimes resources are fixed in the sense that you cannot have more than 150 to 130 whatsoever. It's not practical, it's not in terms of money, in terms of time, in terms of whatever. So you know that you can't have larger than. So you should could ask yourself this, okay, given this amount of participants, what kind of effect I can realistically detect? So you can estimate the effect size that you can find with sufficient power given the sample size. This is called sensitivity analysis. And this allows you to answer questions such as, okay, for instance here, I have no more than 200 participants. A very simple design like before. 100 one group, the other 100 other group, power 80, alpha 0.05. What is the effect size I can detect given this probability that I accept as error? I can detect basically 0.39 or more, of course. So 0.39, 0.40 to round up, or more. And that's it. That could be very valuable, because you can arrive at the conclusion, okay, you should ask yourself this question. Is it a realistic exercise? Given my design, given the experiment, given the data collection, is it a realistic exercise? If it is too large, then try to change something, because otherwise you are simply asking for trouble. Try to change something means, well, can you collect some more participants? Or can you increase the strength of your experiment? Can I have a larger effect size? There are ways in which you can do that. Ask yourself this question. And this is the kind of sensitivity plot that you can do N by effect size, so you can construct here what is the effect size given the sample size and so on, given a certain sample size, you can do different steps, and by power, so you can basically do it in different ways. You can inspect scenarios around the effect size and so on and so forth.
Okay. There are your,
That's okay, because I think the clock stopped, so I don't know if it's a sign that my clock stopped or whatever. I thought 5 minutes ago was still the same time, so something wrong. Okay, so this is the kind of logic, and you can inspect scenarios around different things. Now, quickly, there's two different groups. You can do different effect size, as I mentioned at the beginning, for different types of design. Two repeated measures, that's, for instance, it's a different type of effect size that you would do. And the only thing I mention here, because I will say it's a bit more on repeated measure in a second, later, is that there is often a mistake. This is not Cohen's D, this is Cohen DZ. And often in the literature it's reported as Cohen's D, but it's not correct. It's Cohen DZ, and you can double check if it corresponds by calculating T divided square root of N, and then you understand whether it's Cohen's D or Cohen's DZ. But just to say that this is fair, because the difference is that this is a standard deviation within, but not between. That's why it's called. But anyhow, one thing that I will put some emphasis on, that everything has to be equal. A within design has much more power than a between design. And this has a lot of implication. Now, I will just show you a very simple example now, and a more articulate example in a moment. This is basically effect size. This is the curve of the effect size, different effect size, right? Suppose gamma there is the Greek letter is the effect size in the population. So it's a Cohen's D, but it's written delta in the population. So it's not something else. It's this is the effect size given that you have in the between sub-participant design for two groups of 25 participants each. This is the power that you would have given this effect size. So with effect size 0.5, you will have a power of 0.54, a bit more than tossing the coin, with 25 participants per group. Given 25 participants in total, with half of the effect size, given an effect size of the same size, you have a power of 0.73. So it's much more power given the less participants, given the same effect size. So that's one example. I will come back to this. Depends also on R, the correlation between the two. I will come back to this point and expand it. Now, quickly to other types of design. Analysis of variance 2x2. You can, we are going to see this in the context of a Lex experiment, but one thing that you can use a different effect size, which is called F, is the effect size F for Cohen, of this. And just to have a quick understanding, the effect size F is roughly half of Cohen's D. That gives you a sense of it. I mean, it's more complicated than this because this depends on different groups. So it depends 2x2, 2x3, 2x4. So the effect size mix is not exactly the same as Cohen's D. But the quick translation from one to the other is half of the effect size expressing Cohen's D. And that's another thing that I suggest. Yeah, there are different kinds of metrics. Eta squared, T odds ratio, DR. Just think of it like you go in Japan and you need to use yen. And you don't know how much a yen is worth, so you translate lei in yen. When you go to France, you translate lei to euro. I mean, it's just a question of translating in the unit, which are comfortable, more comfortable. And there are different units in different design, but you can always translate them back. And this gives you a sense, an intuition, whether the effect size is large, small, and so on and so forth. Although it's a bit more complicated, but still gives you an intuition. Now, if you have more complex design, and sometimes you have, you can try to often to simplify them with a focus contrast approach. So basically, you can think in terms of the focal hypothesis and focus the pattern or expected means using contrast weights so that you are going to test the power of that focal hypothesis. Now, often you think in terms of the whole design is significant or insignificant, so you might ask yourself a question, is this design statistically significant, sufficiently powerful? And that's a wrong question. The only question that you can answer is this focal effect that I'm focusing on, I have sufficient power to find it? Now, sometimes you can have in mind the focal effect as a generic interaction. Some other times you can specify it in terms, okay, I expect this means to be different from this evidence. If you are at that level of sophistication, please do it. Because that's the contrast approach to power analysis, which allows to simplify, to be more precise in terms of what you really need, how many participants you really need, with the effect size you expect. And that's the kind of logic of the contrast weights, for instance, here, in terms of main effect, the interaction effect. And it depends on the pattern of means you expect. So you need to think in terms of means. One tip that I can give, here I'm not using that tip, but one tip that I can give depends on you. If you are able to have an intuition of what kind of means you expect, great, go for it. If you don't, use fictitious means, 0, standard deviation 1. Because then is you think in terms of what is the coincidence that I would expect. And that perhaps is a unit you are more used to. So it depends on you. But if you standardize this and use 0, 1, standard deviation 1 and 0 as a starting point, then the pattern of means is as if I expect half of a coincidence here, half a coincidence there, one coincidence, and so you can have a sense, okay, that's too much, that's not enough, and so on and so forth. Here is one example, a trivial example, that's how you do it. And in any case, the point is that this is the kind of, in this specific example, that's the kind of effect size, which means once you calculate this effect size, then you plug it in G power, and you can calculate how many participants you need. In this example, you don't need that many participants, only 34, because it's a very large effect. Similar for a moderation study, if you want to plan a moderation study, you can still think in terms of basically, it depends on the type of moderation you expect. So depending on the design, you should be able in terms, I'm going to be quick on this because we don't have the time to develop. But the point is basically, let me go back to this one. Sorry if I, because here it's easier to understand it. It's the same rule like in the regression. So I showed in the regression, which is the simplest way to understand. Basically, when you do a moderation analysis, you are assuming that there are different mean slopes. So the point that you really should ask yourself, how much are different the slopes? Depending on that, you can calculate back the effect size that you need to have that kind of things, can be expressed. The effect size using this approximation, F squared, which is F before squared, F squared, the same as before, can be approximated by the basically the difference in the slope of the two conditions, whatever these conditions are. So which means in practice, for instance here, in one group I expect a beta or a correlation of 0.05, the other group 0. That's the beta of the interaction. Based on that, you can calculate F squared. Based on that, you can calculate the main participants. So basically you can, I think, besides the detail, the main message is you can use this with a simple ANOVA design, with the interaction effect, it's a moderation effect. You can do the regression approach with a qualitative moderator, so dichotomic moderator, or you can do it with quantitative moderators by using plus one standard deviation, minus one standard deviation. In all these cases, what you can, you ask yourself a simple question to answer. The simple question to answer is, rather than what is the effect size there that you have no idea what is the realistic effect size, just to say, is it realistic this difference between these two conditions. Is this very easy to expect that, I don't know, in the experimental condition there is a correlation between the dependent value and the dependent value of 0.50, in the experiment, the control conditions minus 0.50, or 0, or 0.20. The difference is 20, or 30, or 0.40. Is this difference very easy? If it is, then you go for the power based on this difference. If it isn't, think again, go back and think in ways in which you can increase, improve your design. And again, once you have this, you can plug it in G power and use the calculation of any participants you need. And again, you can do it with continuous moderator, the continuous moderator, and with, in general, with the means and of effect. The general rule is that basically you think in terms of how much the moderation effect is changing, canceling, or diminishing the effect. If the moderation is just a diminishing effect, then you need thousands of participants to arrive with other motivation. If the moderation means in one condition you have no effect, in the other is substantial effect, then you need hundreds perhaps of participants. If the moderation means you revert the effect, in one condition is positive, in the other is negative, then you can need even dozens of participants. I'm saying this because I've been blocked saying you need 16 times the number of these, depends on what you expect. So if you have a flip over, kind of entirely different moderation, kind of disjointed moderation, which has two different opposite directions, then even few participants can be enough. If you have a minor change in the slope, then you need thousands of participants. One is participants. And you can, it's the same rule applied in all these kind of cases, but the general rule is the same. Now, mediation regressionized, I'm not going to say anything. Julia will say something after on this. Well, the last point I will try to make is about this part, which I will skip again, all many details, but I'll try to go to the bottom line, which I think is very important. And this is using this other software, which is CLIMPS. It's another software available. It's like the one that you showed by Westphal, Joe, and so on, but it's a different type of approach, but this is a medical field. So they use different names and so on. That basically allows to do mixed model and among other things. I focus here only on the mix ANOVA. I focus on the within versus between, using a two-by-two design, first as a mixed design, and then changing the design. So I start with a mix ANOVA, that's the website, that's blah, blah, blah. And one nice feature of this is that you want to do a study, you save it, and then you can upload. So the next time, the first time you need to fill in many things, but the next time you upload it, you make minor changes. You don't need to start from scratch again every time. You can solve, as always, in power analysis for sample size or for power. So you say, I want this power, 0.80, or you can say, I want different types of power, so you can have a range of solutions. To focus here, I will go on for the simplest one, and just say, I want 0.80 power, 80% of power, and you solve for sample size. So everything that becomes how many participants I need to achieve this power given the design. Or you could solve for sample size. Given that I have this sample size, how much power I will have given this sample size. So you can solve in different ways the equation. You need to define test on alpha. I'm gonna go quick, but the point is basically you have subtle statistical difference between the test. That's the most commonly used. As they say, it's nice because they have some kind of didactical. If you are unsure which to pick, pick this one. Pick the default. Otherwise, don't mess up. So either you know what you're doing, or pick this one. That's the kind of, I find it nice. Also, they say some kind of, the results are a bit didactical. They say explain things like what is the type of error, blah, 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 which is alpha, so on and so forth. Okay. Then you define, they call it outcomes, not dependent particle test. Medicine, this is how they call it, they tend to call it this way. Then the routine factor, repeated measures. You need to define whether it's numerical, categorical, a few things like the number of measurement time, because in complex design can make a difference of medical spacing, but we are not focusing on this. We are just very simple thing, numeric routine factor. Here, I skip this part, is the clustering. So you can do a mixed model, this, because you can model the clustering as well. And fixed predictor basically is what we call the independent variable, or between factors, basically. And again, nominal, continuous, blah, blah, blah. You define this. This is control experimental. Then it's asking you, okay, what you are interested in? I'm saying the interaction effect, rather than the Penn effect or even the grand mean. But yeah, I'm interested in the interaction effect between and within. Right. Then this is, again, all kinds of very detailed, advanced question about the type, the constraint compared to the matrices. But these are useful for more complex models, like the correlation covariance matrix. You can model this as well. For the mixed model, this is very important. Here, no less. The point is, what kind of expected means under the key hypothesis? This is not intelligent exercise, but expected means. Again, if you use the tip I showed you before, here I say that the standard deviation is equal to where it is.
Here.
The standard deviation is equal to 1, I say, which means 5, 5, 5, 6 is 1 constant. So if I each fix the standard deviation equal to 1, you can use 0, 0, 0, 1, or I use 5 because 0, 10, 5 is in between. In my way of thinking, 5 is kind of middle point. But you can use 0 to avoid the negatives. So you can use 0 and so on and so forth, as you like. The point is, if you use standard deviation of 1, this is as if to say, between this condition, there is a difference of 1 coincidence. So basically what you are saying here is that this is a simple design which will control time before and after, right? Imagine the kind of experimental context, you have a baseline measure, the experimental intervention, and a measure after the intervention, very simple. Baseline, then control experiment, five, whatever that time is. After the experimental manipulation, control stays on five, and experimental goes up to six. So I'm saying there is a change of one constant in that group. Everything else becomes equal. There is no effect, right? That's the kind of, I'm translating new numbers, this kind of hypothesis in my head. And this is because I say that the standard deviation is equal to one, so it's all based on that. It's as if I'm expressing changes in standard deviation units. You can do it in real numbers, real data, if you have an hypothesis about milliseconds and standard deviation milliseconds. Perfect. But just as a simple tip. Now, you go up and say, okay, how much they are correlated between each other, the measures, the repeated measure, the baseline, the outcome. Here, I start with 0.5. There are also more complicated ways of determining the correlation, but here I start with, there's a correlation of 0.5 between baseline and after the measure. And when you do all of this, at the end you hit calculate there, it's telling you that you did everything that you should have done, and it's telling you how many participants you need, given this. Now, it is interesting part. Given all of this, 34 participants in this kind of design. Okay, suppose the expected correlation is true. Becomes 0.25 the correlation, becomes 50 participants. Suppose there is no correlation between baseline and after. So it's very difficult. Usually you have correlation because the people is the same. So it's like when you have the kind of take the after expression there, and you just have baseline after, you have differences in variation, variability of people. But suppose there is no correlation, you need 66 participants, given everything else. Okay. Let's recap. The design was a 2x2 mix ANOVA. Required power at 80% with zero correlation, 66, 25, 50, 50, 34 participants. Okay? So, first, required N goes down as the correlation between the dependent variable and the repeated measure goes down. First lesson, let's see. Now, suppose instead it's a 2x2 between. What I skip all the details here. What I want to focus is that this is the exact same hypothesis, 5, 5, 5, 6, but between subjects. The pattern of means is exactly the same. I need 128 participants. Suppose it's a 2x2 full within the sign. Correlation 0.25, I need 20 participants. Correlation 50, correlation 0, I need 10 participants, 34 participants. Let's put that. This is design, 2x2, simple design. ANOVA mixed between routines. In all cases, I'm saying that's the same effect size. The effect size is the same. The pattern of means is always the same. How many participants I need for the same power in between the size? I go from 128 to 10 participants. Should I say anything more on why within subject design and more power? Everything has been equal. I mean, to be fully honest with you, when I did this, I didn't expect this. I knew that there are differences. Everyone knows them. You read in the book. I did not expect the scale of the difference when I did the calculation. I repeated the calculation more than once, just to be sure. I did not expect the scale of the difference. Given everything that's similar, I did not expect to be talking about a difference of a scale from 10 to 120. It's not few participants, less participants. So, let's go to some development. How you can increase power? Obviously, increase sample size. But think about using within subject design. If you can, sometimes you can't because of the many things. I mean, you can't use in the same group two kind of clinical therapeutic intervention, one before or after. So you have to start designing, but you can't do the within. But if you can, think in terms of within. You can administer stronger treatments, I mean, kind of increase the difference between the experiment manipulation. Of course, you need to be aware that this could be at the cost of ecological validity, so you have to be careful on this. And a series of other things. I'm just going to say quickly, and then I pass to Giulio, on power without increasing sample size. Increase sample size, you know, but you can also increase power without increasing sample size. And how it comes, again, our friend, the standard error. The standard error is telling us that depends on N, the standard deviation. So if you fix N, the smaller standard deviation is the previous. And the standard deviation means the variability in the data. Sometimes you can reduce standard deviation by better design. You can spend extra one day thinking about your design, making a cleaner design, and you gain hundreds of hours of power of participants, whatever, just by doing the design cleaner. And as you were mentioning before this morning, the standard deviation depends both on N and K, the number of trials, which means that you can, to some extent, train participants for trials. Depends on how much is the variability in trials compared to variability in persons, in people. Basically, is that you can increase power also by increasing stigma, by increasing trials, by increasing items. If you think about the co-measure, by increasing items, you can increase also power. You never think in persuading these things, but that's another way of thinking. And these are kind of combinations. I mean, if you're interested, there are at least a couple of papers, are really nice papers. These are kind of in combination of different types of combination between trials and participants, and how power is affected by both. I mean, just to be clear, if you increase participants, you'll never grow. Power goes always up, and it's always more effective than trials. But there are equations in which also trials can have a large. So you can increase items, and then you have a very good increase in power, even, and this is special when participants are costly. So if you think about psychophysical experiments, sometimes they have one, two, three participants, but they have hundreds of trials. So is this all crap without power? I don't think so. Sometimes they're very reliable, robust results. But it's the phenomenon they're looking at, the individual difference variance, which is lower, relatively speaking, people compared to within persons. And if you have many trials, you can compensate for lower amount of people. Again, it's not about the signal and the noise. And the final thing, but there is no time to this, just as I say, post-hoc power to be sleepy.
If you want, I was thinking maybe you can finish and then I can put some of the power tomorrow in the plotting session. So go.
But that will be quick anyway. But there are a few slides left, I mean, no worry, I just already compressed most of it. Basically, I only spend a few seconds to say one of the main problems in power analysis is that you don't know the effect size. And you don't know it by definition, because if you would know the effect size, you wouldn't run the study. Why would you? You already know the answer. So if you already know the answer, you don't ask the question. It's very simple, you already know the answer. So by definition, you are in a kind of ontological situation where you don't know And you cannot know the effect size. The best you can guess. And you can guess can be wrong. The point is that when you guess, you have uncertainty in the estimate. So what do you do with the uncertainty? And first, what happens with uncertainty? I show it with these equivalent ways of showing it, but the point is that underestimation, so if you think that your effect size, overestimation, if you think your effect size is larger than it is, has a very stronger effect on power compared to underestimation. This is because the power curve is not linear, which means that, let's see, well, here perhaps is the best way to say it. Suppose that you have a best guess, you think the effect size is 0.4. That's your best guess, based on the literature, pilot study, whatever. Your best answer is 0.4. Suppose you got it wrong. You got it wrong. So you are offset by 0.8. If you are offset because it wasn't 0.4 but 0.5, so you underestimated the effect size, well, it means that you ask, given your guess, you thought 150 participants are enough, well, you could have been okay with 100 participants instead. So you had a difference of 50 participants, right? You had 50 participants extra. Now, suppose you got it wrong by 10, same quantity, but this time you overestimated. So you thought it was 0.4 instead of 0.3. You would have needed 275 participants. So you are under power by 125 participants, almost half. That's a general, unless your effect size is very large, and that has to do with the asymmetry of the impact of the best guess, or the error in the estimates, which is much stronger, the impact, if you make an overestimation. And guess what? Overestimation are more likely than underestimation. It's your design. It's your thing. There's optimistic bias. Everyone thinks all kind of planning fallacy bias. So the point is that power depends on the estimated effect size. The overestimation is much more common than the underestimation. So there is an asymmetric effect. It's more likely overestimation, and this is also an asymmetric effect. So the point is that you should consider not a single value, but different scenarios. This is a way to protect yourself. You can do it in a formal way, you can do it in informal way, doesn't matter. The point is that you need to be careful in terms of considering more scenarios as opposed to a specific value. You could consider, for instance, a minimal effect of interest, which is, provides a boundary in terms of, okay, given that's the minimum, you don't ask yourself, what is the effect to ask? But you ask yourself, what is the minimum effect that would be interesting? I think it's a very sensible question. Also has some implications. Okay, given this minimum effect, do I have enough power? And that's one way in which you can try. You should consider sensitivity analysis, which means the consequences of doing different kinds of scenarios. And then you can also use safeguard analysis. But yeah, there are different ways. I mean, that's not the point. The point is that you need to be aware that the trick is that you don't know the effect size by definition. So be sure that you should be certain of being uncertain. You know for sure that you don't know. And this should inform your decisions. Should be able to take this in mind, to be humble in terms of making your decision, to acknowledge that you might get it wrong. If you anticipate this, you try to create a buffer. And this buffer, it reduces the likelihood that you're getting it wrong. So, summing up power analysis is one way, important way to plan a study. Try to plan your study adequately. As we saw, these are the main points. Think in terms of range of values, just to give a kind of intuition. Just think about power as full in a tank. You want to go somewhere in the desert, you have some, well, perhaps should find something around there, and the power is how much fuel you want to put in your tank. And you cannot put all the power in the world, because you need to bring other stuff in the tank. So you need to decide. But you don't want to have not enough fuel if you are in the desert. You would like to have enough fuel just to go there to find something. If it's not there, you think, okay, was not there. You don't want to go there, you don't find anything. But I didn't have enough fuel to look around and to check well for that. So that's one way to think it. Increasing power means to decrease errors in general. Now, more complex design are challenged, multi-level design. The problem is that sometimes there is no algorithm solution. One general way to approach this is with the presentation that Julia will do now, using a simulation approach. That's a general way to approach human design that cannot be solved mathematically. There is no mathematical solution. These are some leading advanced issues. And before going to Julia, say to yourself, you've got the power. I've got the power. Kick out. We've got the power. So,
yeah. And before.